any other questions I can I can offer to the one?
You have any more books coming out that you think might be turned into movies?
I don't know about that. That I mean.
Me and Zac Efron.
Yeah, right. It's so unbelievable that this happened, that I can't. I mean, the reason that this book got made into a movie was that the screenwriter, Vince Palmo, who's from Austin, Texas, was walking, he told me this, was walking by a little independent bookstore in Austin, Texas. He saw it in the window, and he said, "This looks like an interesting title." Mm-hmm. Then he took it home and he read it, and he gave it to his friend, Richard Linklater, and said, "I think you should read this." And Linklater read it over the summer vacation and optioned the film rights with his own money. And that's why it happened. Didn't happen because of any agent, didn't happen because of any, I mean, that's really extraordinary. And that it actually got made. You know, it's one thing to option it, but then that they actually got the $20 million together from this huge consortium of investors all over the world. It's pretty, remarkable. So again, it's playing right now at a lot of theaters in the United Kingdom, and then I think 131 theaters in America. And I think it's sort of an art house release now, and I think they're watching, you know, the numbers, who's coming, how many people are coming, and I think that will determine how wide they're going to put it out before it goes to DVD. And also, I think whether Christian McKay gets a Best Supporting Actor nomination, that would determine it too.
I think I saw it as a preview when we saw Precious.
Oh.
It was a preview. That was in Linden.
Yeah, all right, good. You know, no, and I know they paid a lot of money to have the trailer shown before New Moon, the vampire movie. Yeah. Yeah. Because they're hoping that some of the Zach girls, you know, the Zach fan girls. I don't know whether the Zach fan girls are gonna come for this movie or not. It may be I hope they would. I mean, I think on a certain level this movie's a love story with Zach Efron, and I mean, even if you don't like Shakespeare or I remember Linklater told me they had a preview in Austin. This is when they were still cutting the movie. For people 25 years and younger. They just want to see how it would play with young people. And the audience really liked it. You know, they liked it. And then at the end, one of the producers, John Sloss, stood up and he said, "How many people in the audience knew who Orson Welles was?" And no one in the audience raised their hand. But they liked it, and they just said, "Well, he's like a cool villain." And we liked it. And I thought, yeah, why not? He is sort of a charismatic villain in the movie. He's, you know, obviously a fantastically talented man, and also, you know, self-absorbed and, you know, egomaniac in many ways. But you forgive him almost everything because of his vision and his talent along the way. Yes.
I have two questions. Sure. The final version of the film, is this the way that you perceived it? I mean, if you could change something, would you have changed anything? Also, in England, their perspective on film and theater is a lot different than in the States. They're grounded in different ways. So, I mean, if there's a comparison.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's a good question. I don't think there's anything I would change in the movie. I like the version that's now. One of the first things that struck me when I saw the screenplay was that the book is written first person, and there's no voiceover in the film at all, which would have been the easy way to go. That would have been the easy way. Just take all these hunks of the book and just do them as voiceover. And the fact that the writers found a way to get around that and to externalize all that inner stuff, I thought was very clever and I thought worked pretty well. So like that scene that I read you with Zach on the roof, you know, there's all this stuff about, you know, the world and paradise and what he's going to have and everything. And in the film, you know, when he has that little scene with Claire Danes and Claire Danes says, Zach says, "I wish you luck." And Claire Danes says, "I don't believe in luck." And Zach goes, "Yeah, I don't believe in luck anymore either." It's kind of a relief not to believe. I mean, you get in that mm-hmm. scene in the film, you see how he's grown in that scene, and he's sort of been broken by the experience, and he's wiser and sadder without having to tell you that. You just see that it's like a coming of age thing for him, that his experience with her has been, you know, romantic, but also very sort of, you know, damaging in a way, and he's older than that. Yeah, in England, I mean, Linklater told me when they were rehearsing the film, he said, I remember when he said, the thing I'm worried about is the Shakespeare, because he never had done that before. And then he said to me, once they started, he goes, this is in England, they know how to do Shakespeare. Because I didn't have to do anything with Shakespeare. Because they just, you know, these are people from the Royal Academy, they all can do it, they can do the verse. You know, and they had a guy from the Globe Theater, this guy Giles Bach, as the advisor, and he would just, you know, do little corrections when somebody missed a word or missed a punch. But I mean, they really had it, you know, and so I think that was the, that turned out to be the easy part of the movie for him, the Shakespeare, and that's what he was worried about most. No, Linklater said to me when this had its debut in Austin, he was very generous. He said, I think this is my best film, he said, which I thought was a kind thing to say. I think for him it's his most ambitious movie, you know, that he tried to do Shakespeare in New York and period and all this kind of stuff. I would imagine his most financially successful film has been School of Rock, in terms of the film that made the most money, which is a funny film. This is more serious. And it's a little...
Period is really Vogue now, in education.
Yeah.
That's getting reintroduced.
Like,
this period, people really
want to
see it.
Yeah, well, I hope, like I said, I hope people go see it. Yes.
Yeah, I was just wondering, when you were first notified, when you said that they found your book in a bookstore, but when would they first contact you?
Well, I got an email from the publisher that said, it isn't definite yet, but it looks like Richard Linklater wants to buy the film option on the book. And I was like, yeah. This was 3 years after the book came out. Wow. You know, so it was like, great. You know? It was. And then, as I said, I think he renewed the option once the following year, and then the film was green-lighted, and it was sort of, it happened. But, yeah, no, it's pretty, you know, and I had some, before this, before the book was even published, I had Carl Reiner, the film director, he had option. I had tried the book, because I couldn't get the book published, believe it or not, for a long time. I couldn't get the book published for 9 years. Mm-hmm. I sent the manuscript around. And during that time, I thought, you know, maybe I have the form wrong. So I did it as a screenplay. And I showed it to a friend of mine who was a producer out there, and he showed it to his friend, Carl Reiner. And Reiner bought an option for a year, along with George Shapiro, the producer of Seinfeld. That's how I have some of the editions have a quotation from George Shapiro on the cover, because I know him. And for a year, Reiner tried to get the movie made, and he couldn't get money for it. You know, I think it's just people are like, well, you know, who's Orson Welles, and that's an old story, and you know, it was difficult. And he really loved the screenplay. But I got to meet Carl Reiner, and I got to meet Mel Brooks. Mm-hmm. That was really nice. I went to have lunch with Reiner in New York, and Mel Brooks showed up at the table because they were promoting a 2,000-year-old man or something like that, and it was funny. And Mel Brooks just he said to me, what did you order? And I said, for lunch. And I said, I ordered the free-range chicken. And then Brooks goes, I don't like the term free-range. He goes, it gives the chicken too much hope. Better it should be suffocated, strangled chicken. And then he just, that's all he did for the hour. It's like wherever anybody said, He just tore it apart, you know, and I just saw, God, that's Reiner's relationship with Brooks for 40 years, is that Brooks just does this thing, you know, that he can't stop, you know, it's Jewish Tourette's, he can't stop it, because, you know, they bring the bill to Reiner, who's going to pay it, and Brooks stops his hand, he goes, don't accept that. He goes, it's just their first offer. And it was just, it was funny and exhausting. It really was exhausting. So even though they didn't make the movie, I got a lot of laughs. My Mel Brooks moment. And then he was giving out these books, these 2,000-year-old man books, and he gave me one, and I asked him to sign it, and he wrote on it, to Robert Kaplow, one of the few Kaplows I really like. He had met me for 30 seconds when he had written that, so I do have my little Mel Brooks. Thank you all for coming. I'm happy to see you.